Hey yo, welcome to Astronaut. It's been a minute since I made a video, so I apologize for that, but you know, time is relative, so we're moving on. Anyways, let's talk about supernovae. Supernovae are the result of explosions of massive stars, but believe it or not, there is more than one way for a star to explode, and because of that, we classify supernovae into multiple types. There are two main types of supernovae, type 1 and type 2. Pretty straightforward, right? Well, we distinguish and categorize supernovae based on their absorption lines. Type 2 supernovae include hydrogen lines in their spectra, while type 1 do not. Type 2, hydrogen. Type 1, no hydrogen. First, we're going to talk about type 2, which I know sounds a little bit backwards, but they're a little bit easier to understand, and so I think it's a good starting point. Type 2 supernovae occur when very massive stars, at least 8 times as massive as the Sun, collapse on themselves. This internal explosion gives them the title core collapse supernovae. Massive stars burn through many elements during their lifetime. In their core, a star starts off with burning hydrogen into helium. As it does so, it generates enough outward pressure to keep the star from collapsing on itself. I have a video that explains this process, known as hydrostatic equilibrium, in a little bit more detail in case you're interested in learning more about how a star sustains itself. So if you're interested, feel free to click on the link above. Once the hydrogen in the core has expired, the helium will fuse into carbon and oxygen, which will fuse into neon, which will fuse into more oxygen and then silicon until finally we end up with a nickel iron core. As fusion occurs, the elements that were originally in the core will be pushed into outer layers surrounding the core. At this point, there's an immense amount of gravity acting on the core, and the core can't generate enough energy to effectively push back. As a result, the core collapses and it's crushed into an extremely dense spinning sphere. Material from the outer layers of the star, so think about the other elements that were in the core before and now are in the outer layers, fall towards the dense core. But at this point, the core is so hard that the material bounces off the core, generating a shock wave. This shock wave can be powerful enough for the star to explode. And that's how we get the supernova. Depending on its mass, the leftover core, the really dense spinning sphere, will either become a neutron star or continue to collapse even more into a black hole. So now let's talk about type 1 supernovae. Usually, type 1 supernovae come in the form of something that we call type 1a supernovae. We also call these thermonuclear supernovae. Thermonuclear meaning nuclear reactions that occur at a very high temperature, which makes sense for a star. In a type 1a supernova explosion, a white dwarf accretes, that's just another fancy word to say that it steals, matter from its companion, which is usually a low mass star like the Sun. The white dwarf continues to increase in mass until it reaches about 1.4 solar masses. Then, boom, the white dwarf can no longer be sustained under electron degeneracy pressure, so it collapses. Now, you don't need to know what electron degeneracy pressure is in depth, just know that it's the pressure that was keeping the star from collapsing before. So while gravity was pressing in on the star, forcing it to want to collapse, electron degeneracy pressure was pushing back. But at some point, right, it can't do that anymore, and so the star collapses. This threshold, 1.4 solar masses, is known as the Chandrasekhar limit. Type 1a supernovae have a strong silicon absorption line at 615 nanometers. Type 1b and 1c supernovae, on the other hand, lack that strong silicon absorption line. That's what makes them different, or one of the things that makes them different. Type 1b and 1c supernovae are thought to occur when a massive star that has lost some of its layers undergoes core collapse, and because of this, they're called stripped core collapse supernovae. So the process of formation is kind of similar to type 2 supernovae. However, remember type 1 do not have hydrogen, so that includes type 1b and 1c. They do not have hydrogen. One of the main differences between type 1b and 1c supernovae is that type 1b includes strong helium lines, while type 1c does not. So that's just to break down a few of the different types of supernovae, but the ones that you really need to remember, right, the ones that are most relevant when we're talking about what we see in the world are type 1a and type 2 supernovae. Type 2 supernovae are generally found in the spiral arms of galaxies, where young massive stars are commonly found. type 1a supernovae are more often found in elliptical galaxies, which contain older stars. That's pretty much all for today, so thank you so much for watching and spending a few minutes here with me. I really appreciate it, and I hope you learned something. I feel like